morning's Joel Crane from Cobalt Blue. Joel, good morning.
Good morning, Andrew.
Good to be speaking. Look, an update from you this week. The demo plant, give us a bit more detail. How's that going?
Sure. Well, this week we did publish an update on the status and development of our demonstration plant. Since the start of the year, we've designed, built, and are now commissioning this week, which will begin operation of this demonstration plant. Basically, the facility is an upgrade of last year's pilot plant and a test version of what will become the full-scale plant a few years from now. So basically, the plant will treat somewhere between 3,000 and 4,000 tons and produce tons of ore and produce about 10 tons of cobalt products. That'll be either MHP, which typically has about 30% cobalt and 5% nickel, or cobalt sulfate. So the ore that we're getting has basically been sourced from a 60-meter-long underground portal. And then from there, the ore will be crushed, followed by dry milling to about 1 millimeter, and then processed into a concentrate using very standard gravity spirals. And then this concentrate will be treated with our patented flow sheet to recover the cobalt and the elemental sulfur as the byproduct.
So what's your timing, Joel? How long will the demo plant run for?
Well, that 3,000 to 4,000 tons of ore turned into 10 tons of product will run for about 6 months or so. So basically what we're going to try and do is gather as much data as we can that'll feed into the definitive feasibility study, which will be finished around a year from now. We'll do things like running 3 20-day campaigns where we'll run sort of 24/7 shifts, just allow us to understand the process and make adequate adjustments to those, you know, everything from the valves to the kiln to whatever sort of comes up along the way. And also help us to understand the cost structures of a lot of our inputs, how much we need, reagents and all that sort of stuff. And then most importantly, we'll be able to send that finished product to some of our commercial partners for testing and qualification.
And give us some insight, Joel, as far as the cobalt space. How's the price holding up?
Sure. I mean, watchers of this space will know that cobalt has not been immune to this latest market sell-off for a number of reasons that we can sort of spend all day talking about, but specifically in cobalt and a number of other China-centric commodities. I think that the COVID shutdowns that we're seeing over there over the past several months that really hindered the supply chain, it stopped end users of cobalt, the battery makers, from having their plants running at full capacity. So you just started seeing a little bit of excess commodity around there and really helping cause some of that price decline. But also at the same time, and in commodity world, this is the same for any asset, is once the price starts falling, end users or consumers get a little bit wary of purchasing at a time when price continues to fall, if they don't get stuck with higher price inventory. So it feels like we've got a bit of inventory laying around and that'll get chewed up as consumers have to return to market. And I expect, just like other commodities, we'll eventually find a bottom and start to pick up again. But look, this is all sort of short-term noise. The market remains structurally sound in the sense that demand for cobalt and the other battery materials remains very, very strong at a time when supply is quite constrained. So for us, don't worry too much about the short-term noise. It's a very structurally sound market in the longer term.
Good to speak. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Andrew.